The chairman is with us today to say a few words about the CWC. I also wanted to mention two other things. One, we have a statement, a joint statement, which we will be providing to you a little later in the day regarding the CWC, which has been authorized by former Secretaries Brown, Perry, and Richardson on this same subject. And then at 2 o'clock this afternoon, we have Deputy Undersecretary of Defense for Environmental Affairs, Sherry Goodman, coming down to talk to you about an initiative that is connected with the environmental area. And with that, I'll turn over the proceedings to General John Shalikashvili, the chairman.
Sir. Thanks.
I know that you have heard and read an awful lot in the last few weeks about the Chemical Weapons Convention. And I want to let you know where this country's military leaders, that is the Joint Chiefs and the combatant commanders, stand on the CWC. From the beginning of our CWC debate in 1991, the Joint Chiefs then and we, their successors, have supported this important convention. We have consistently done so because no matter how much we analyzed the provisions of this convention, we always came to the same conclusion, that our troops will be safer with the convention than without it. Simply stated, the CWC will greatly reduce the likelihood that our troops and citizens will face chemical weapons in the future. Furthermore, well before the CWC was negotiated, Congress had already directed the destruction of the vast majority of our chemical weapons stockpile. The CWC will require other state parties to do the same, and under very strict international controls. So since we are already destroying our own chemical weapons, it makes great sense to level the playing field, and the CWC does just that. Important as well, we do not need chemical weapons to provide an effective deterrent. Deterrence is based on a defensive capability and on an ability to rapidly deliver an overwhelming and devastating response. And we have both of those capabilities. And the CWC is not going to lure us into complacency. We are fully committed to the continued improvement of our chemical defensive capabilities and our aggressive intelligence collection. We recognize that there are rogue states that will not sign up to the convention. But even there, the CWC will make it harder for rogue states to acquire chemical weapons by imposing strict trade restrictions on relevant chemicals required to make such weapons. While this is not the full answer in dealing with rogue states, here too, it is obvious to us that we are better off with the convention than without it. Furthermore, this convention enjoins the world community to forego an entire class of weapons of mass destruction. It implements a regime of enforcement to include most rigorous inspections, and it impairs the ability of those outside of the convention to obtain materials to make chemical weapons. In a final analysis, despite the objections sometimes raised, the CWC makes great sense to me, to the other Joint Chiefs, and to our combatant commanders, and we continue to urge its prompt ratifications. And with that, I'm ready to try to answer your questions.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I wonder if we might have a couple of questions on other subjects. We might. NORAD announced yesterday that it's gone on an increased state of alert because of a security problem. I wonder if you might, could you give us any details on the security problem? And with the second anniversary of Oklahoma City coming up, do you plan to put domestic bases on a higher state of alert on the possibility they might be a bombing?
As far as NORAD is concerned, they had indications that they might have a security difficulty, and so they did the natural thing, and that is to increase the security posture on NORAD, somewhat similar as we do sometimes here in the Pentagon when we get some kind of indication that someone is threatening the security of this building. It's no more than that. As far as the second part of your question is concerned, We will remind all commanders of the upcoming anniversary, and we'll urge them to take the measures appropriate in their particular locations.
Could you give us a little more detail? I'm sorry, just to follow up brief, could you give us a little more detail on the security threat at NORAD? The nature of it, was it a local threat? Does it seem to be a part of any larger?
No, they simply had some information that someone was going to try to threaten the facility, and so they took the necessary precaution. Since then, time has come and gone. What they are doing now is simply taking this opportunity to check out their defensive capability, and I suspect that in a not too distant future they will return back to normal.
Thanks. General Shalikashvili, today your predecessor, General Powell, testified on the Hill. He supported the chemical weapons convention. But he also said that the revelations of the past couple of days that the CIA had failed to list Camisea on a list of suspected Iraqi chemical weapons site was, quote, outrageous, and said that if he were still in office, he would be ranting and raving about this. You are in office. What's your reaction to the news of the last couple of days?
Well, I will let General Powell make his own judgments how he would react to it. I'm not one who rants and raves. That doesn't mean that I'm not very much concerned with any kind of information that indicates that we could have provided some warning and didn't. The proper thing to do now, in my judgment, is to ensure that the correct investigations are conducted into the reasons why such information might not have been made available, and to ensure we fix the system so that in the future, if in fact there was this omission, something like that cannot happen again.
Is this an intelligence failure, in your opinion?
Oh, I have no idea. I don't know enough about it other than what the CIA has revealed about that case. So I think it's too early to draw any conclusion.
General, on the Chemical Weapons Convention, as I understand the chief's position is that you feel that you can deter the use of chemical weapons based on the Gulf War without having a chemical weapons deterrent. In your statement of the use of overwhelming and devastating response, does that include the use of nuclear weapons, or is that strictly limited to a conventional response?
I don't think it would be very useful for me to be terribly specific on that issue, other than to tell you that we do not exclude any capability that's at our disposal.
General, could I change the subject to Aberdeen for a second? It seems that sex is a bigger problem at the Aberdeen training facility than at any other U.S. Army training facility in the United States. Do you have any indication why that may be the case?
No, again, I think it's too early to tell whether this is some systemic problem or whether this is simply an issue of individuals having done something very, very wrong. I'm a little reluctant to speak at great detail about any kind of my impressions or not, as long as there's this judicial process ongoing, because I don't think that would be very helpful.
General,
so I think as chairman, I'd better tell you that we need to be very careful before we draw any conclusions, whether there's a systemic problem or whether this is simply a transgression on the part of individuals.
If I could follow, General, will you be involved in any way in the Army review of this matter that's to come with Togo West, I believe, this summer? And secondly, sir, what would you say to the parents, to the families of these female recruits, Army personnel, that question the safety of their daughters in the Army under these circumstances?
I would, first of all, I don't know specifically what review you are referring to that Secretary West and the Chief of Staff of the Army would undertake this summer. I can only assume that this is an Army issue, and so they will conduct a review. I'm sure when they are finished, they will inform me and will inform Secretary Cohen of their results, and we'll take it from there. As far as the parents are concerned of those daughters who, those parents who are afraid for the safety of them, I would say, first of all, how deeply I and all the other leaders regret what might have happened there. But on the other hand, will tell you that I have every confidence that everything is being done by the Army as well as by the other services to ensure that such events do not occur. And I think the commitment of the leadership of all the services has been very strong in that matter, and we're very well aware of our responsibilities to ensure that anybody, regardless of gender or whatever, receives the fair protection and maximum protection and the opportunity to grow and do his or her job. So that's our responsibility, and we recognize it.
I'd like to go back to Aberdeen. We talk about the Air Force review of the bombing at Khobar Towers and the clamor that someone should be held responsible, upper leadership. Do you believe the same thing is true at the Army installation at Aberdeen, that we should be looking at the highest command at Aberdeen?
I think in each case we should look at everyone who might have been responsible. When there is suspicion that some wrong was done by anyone in a chain of command, we need to investigate it. And if the investigation leads us to conclude that a wrong, in fact, was done, then we take the appropriate action in accordance with the Code of Military Justice, if that's what's called for. I don't think there's anyone who's excluded from that process, not I nor anyone else, nor is this a going-in assumption that simply because you're in a chain of command, you must be somehow guilty.
We've got time for one more.
The missing A-10 in Colorado has captured the imagination of a lot of people across the country. I'm sure you've heard some of the theories that are being tossed about. Do you have any opinion on what the situation is there? Do you have any concern that perhaps the plane might have landed, as some people have suggested, rather than crashed? With the upcoming anniversary of Waco and Oklahoma City, the trial going on there, a confluence of events. And are you concerned enough in any way to have taken any precautionary steps with the anniversary coming up?
I think that the first thing that needs to be said, that I feel very much for Captain Button's family in all of this. And secondly, that I'm satisfied that everything is being done to try to find him and the airplane. As far as theories as to what might have happened, I follow very closely all the suggestions as to what might have happened. I simply don't know, and it's as we're now finding out that despite our high-tech attempts and hard work, we have been unable to locate it. So we had not overlooked the idea that the plane might have landed somewhere, and as you know, we have looked at a number of places where that could have happened, so far without any results. So I won't add to the speculation, but I right now my interest is that we continue doing everything we can to answer that question and hopefully to find Captain Buttons and the airplane.
Given how curious the situation is and the confluence of events and the anniversaries and so on, are you thinking about taking any precautionary steps for the anniversary? You mentioned that you were going to remind your commanders across the country about the anniversary. Given the strange situation here, any additional steps being considered?
I do not have enough information to lead me to believe that there's somehow a connection between that incident in Oklahoma City now nearly a year ago and the disappearance of this airplane. My intention is to call to all the commanders' attention the fact that the anniversary is coming and that it's prudent to reevaluate the security situation at their particular installations.
General, I wonder if we could just sneak a quick one in on the QDR while we have you, realizing that no decision, final decision has been made yet. You and the other Joint Chiefs said 4 years ago that you couldn't do with fewer than 1.4 million troops. Given the problems with the budget, the fact that spending is going to be cut and you need to modernize, would you guess that you're going to wind up with a smaller force and fewer bases as a result of the budget problems and the need to modernize?
It's very difficult for me to talk about what we will end up with if the decisions have not been made and Secretary Cohen has not yet made this series of decisions. I can only tell you what we are looking at. We have pledged from the beginning that we would look at everything. And so we have looked at bases, and we have looked end strength, and we have looked at programs, and we have looked at the strategy, and we've looked at all of it. We've looked at overseas presence. Very often we've looked at these things to ensure that when we reject them, we have good rationale for rejecting it. In some cases, we've looked at it to reaffirm that we really can't touch that area of this. And in other cases, we've looked at them because our judgment today might be different than it was before, and we might find that we can make some adjustment. The basis is a perfect example of that. It is very likely that we continue still to have more bases than we need. Whether our final recommendation will be to ask for another base closure, it's too early to tell. So I am satisfied that we're looking at everything that we ought to be looking at, so we can present that as a coherent package to Secretary Cohen. In each case, though, we want to make sure that whatever changes we propose, we take that back to the strategy and bounce it off the strategy and say that if we make this adjustment here, make this reduction there, can we then still execute the strategy? And so for us, the litmus test for the QDR is whether the force that we come up with can execute the strategy today, and that we have the programs in place to have a force in the future that will be appropriate to the environment as we see it out there.
Thank you. Come back soon.
And we'll start again at 2 o'clock. Deputy Undersecretary of Defense for Environmental Security, Sherry Goodman, is with us this afternoon to announce an important initiative in connection with Earth Day. And with that, I will turn it over to Mrs. Goodman.
Thank you, and thanks for that battlefield promotion. I almost got there. Okay. In recognition of Earth Day, I am pleased to announce today that the Defense Department has begun purchasing recycled content paper for all of its copier paper. This change has significant benefits for the environment and for all Americans, and the policy is effective immediately. It will remain in effect as long as the price is lower than virgin paper, and the cost is indeed expected to remain lower. Over the next week, Americans across the country will join together, roll up their sleeves, and work as a team to advance environmental protection. This kind of ethic and teamwork is essential in America today, and the military exemplifies it each and every day on behalf of our country, our people, and our environment. The Defense Department has become one of the nation's most successful and diverse environmental stewards. For Earth Day this year, literally hundreds of our military bases across the country are celebrating such successes as the fact that our number of enforcement actions are down by 80%, even though the number of inspections by regulators remains steady, that our toxic releases are down by 30%, and that just a few weeks ago, DoD won over half of all the White House Closing the Circle awards, more than any other agency, for recycling and waste reduction. The list could go on, but I won't. Secretary Cohen has proclaimed, in honor of Earth Day, that environmental protection is critical to the Defense Department mission, and environmental considerations shall be integrated into all defense activities. And today we take another major step. The Defense Department, as you can see on the charts, purchases over 65% of all the paper bought by GSA for the federal government. We in the Defense Department are trying to lead by example with this initiative. With this change in policy, we will reduce energy consumption and help protect air and water quality. The environmental benefits are substantial, and I think they're best stated by this chart, which notes that we will save 150,000 trees a year by this act, a good-sized forest, and save 60 million gallons of water, the water a million Americans use in a day. In the Department of Defense, we purchase 2.1 million boxes of paper from GSA every year. In 1 week alone, the Pentagon buys 1,040 boxes of paper. If you laid them end to end, the paper we use in 1 week could stretch from Washington to Miami. So we are proud of this step and these environmental benefits. Now, I want to do a little experiment with all of you today. I hope you picked up, as you came in, a copy of this little handout. It says, "Is this recycled content paper? Can you tell the difference?" Now, the experiment is this. Can you tell which one is the recycled paper? Okay, giving you all just a second to check here. Raise your hand if you think it's number one. I see one hand. Raise your hand if you think it's number two. Oh, well, you guys are all very good, but I congratulate you. You've all passed the test. I will tell you, however, I just did this test on another very important person who didn't get it. So that showed to me that this paper indeed really is very, very close to the virgin paper. And now I would like to introduce my colleagues from my two colleagues who are here today. Fran McPolin is the federal environmental executive, and she has been instrumental in getting us to the point. She is our leader on environmental issues in the federal government. And then we will introduce John Stanberry from the General Services Administration. As I mentioned, we purchase most of our paper from GSA, so they also are an important leader in this effort. Fran?
Thank you. I can't tell you how excited we are about this today. Did you know that the federal government purchases 20 billion sheets of paper a year? And that's just the sales from General Services Administration and the Government Printing Office. That's equal, we did some math this morning, it's a little rough, but that's equal to 10 million sheets of paper for every work hour, assuming a 40-hour work week. That's 10 million sheets of paper being used for every work hour that the government is operating. Executive Order 12873 on Federal Acquisition, Recycling, and Waste Prevention was signed by President Clinton in October 1993 to accentuate the importance of using the government purchasing power to stimulate markets for recovered products and to reduce the need to dispose of waste materials. The Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, commonly known as RCRA, Section 6002, and the Executive Order require federal agencies to establish affirmative procurement programs for what are called EPA-designated items, that is, items containing recovered material. And printing and writing paper is one of the biggest targets in that list. What we're trying to do is enhance local and regional economies while protecting our precious natural resources and the environment. Although we have made great strides in buying recycled products over the last 4 years, our performance in purchasing recycled content copier paper has been more than disappointing. Government-wide, the compliance levels for 1996 were close to about 17%. This is due in part to a system that allows government officials a choice to continue procuring the same items purchased for years and years without change. By restricting paper purchases to recycled content copier paper of lesser or equal costs than paper made from virgin fiber, DoD has set an important precedent towards compliance with Executive Order 12873. This decision will help compliance levels for the Department of Defense go up to 100% and will raise the government-wide compliance levels by more than 45%. DOD's new mandate will help provide a much-needed price-stabilizing effect on recycled paper prices by stimulating recycled paper production capacity by more than 2 million boxes every year. This is close to half of the federal government's total copier paper purchases from GSA and GPO combined in 1996. The impact of this policy is so tremendous that we have already started conversations with other federal agencies interested in following DOD's footprints. And as Ms. Goodman said, DOD in this instance is more than leading by example. They really are setting the pace for the other agencies. We congratulate the Department of Defense's environmental and procurement leadership for fully committing to our program goals, to lead by example, to establish the federal government as a leader both domestically and internationally in waste reduction, source separation, and the procurement of recycled content products. Thank you. John?
Thank you, Fran. We in the General Services Administration wishes to congratulate the Department of Defense for taking a giant step in their federal recycling efforts. Not only are they recycling in their office, but they're closing the loop and they're buying recycled. Now, as Sherry told you, Department of Defense is GSA's largest customer, but they're something else to us. They're one of our most valued customers. And Sherry, we look forward to working with you on this exciting new initiative. So again, we would like to congratulate the Department of Defense for their commendable efforts in promoting the environment, and we look forward to working for you in the near future.
Yes.
Is there any difference in the performance of recycled paper in your copiers in this building?
No, this paper will perform as well as the virgin paper. There previously had been differences, which is why it's taken us a little while to get to this point. We wanted to make sure that the performance was as good.
Follow-up, if I may, then, to GSA. If the performance is just as good, why is this not mandated across the entire federal spectrum?
If it's just as good, why isn't it mandated?
Across all federal agencies, its use.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, we have an executive order, 12873. It does say, signed by President Clinton, does say that you will use the paper if as long as it's competitive in price and in performance. And so all the federal agencies should be ordering this from us.
Are they?
At the present time, they are not, but we see that the statistics are getting better each year, but we think with the leadership that we've just given by Ms. Goodman that it's going to be significantly increased. Yes, sir.
Could you just, you and Ms. Goodman, just talk, give us the cost number? You were talking about it would save money a little bit. What are we talking about?
Well, the cost of GSA has lowered the price of its photocopy paper by 5 cents per 5,000 sheet packet.
And how much is a 5,000 sheet packet?
Oh, it's around $20.
Are there figures as to how much DOD will save it over the next year, though, in their budget because of recycling?
The amount DOD will save will depend on what the price of the recycled paper is, and of course that could, because it's a market commodity, that could vary. You could do the calculation if it was 5 cents. We're not doing it because of the large dollar savings, although we expect there will be some because we expect it will be lower. I don't want to predict that amount at the time because just as any commodity, the price could vary a little bit, but we expect there to be some dollar savings, which is good because of course we always benefit from that. We also think that this initial step will positively influence the market for recycled paper because since we're such a large purchaser, we then create incentives for other entities, other federal agencies, state agencies, not only other federal agencies, state governments, municipal governments, and we also help keep the producers of recycled paper, give them an opportunity to make their products more marketable.
Are you doing this, and if you're not, why not, for all paper? Why just copier paper? Why aren't you doing it for stationery and everything else?
Well, we actually already have used most of our letterhead paper. Our stationery is already recycled. So what this does is it brings all the rest of the largest purchase of paper, which is the copier and printer paper. It's called copier paper. I had to ask this question myself, but it turns out it's most of the paper that we use, which is both in printers and copiers, and the other is already, for the most part, already recycled paper.
And just to follow up, obviously, as much as you'd like to have people use recycled paper, you'd like to have them use less of all paper. Is DOD's paper output continuing to climb, or is it leveled off, or is it dropping? What's happening with just the use of paper overall?
Well, certainly I would like to see it decline as we go to the paperless office. And, you know, there are some efforts underway now to make that feasible and viable. And certainly the advances that all the military departments are making in information technology make this much more possible. I think it'll be a little while till we're there yet, but we certainly are hoping that we begin to reduce our use of. I couldn't give you the figure because I just don't have that information. But I will look to see if we can get it for you.
Can you substantiate that? Excuse me, sir. That 150,000 trees in the USA will be spared every year, or is that paper? Are those trees in private hands, in company hands, to be harvested? And isn't that paper going to be sent abroad?
These 150,000 trees would have been used to produce the virgin paper that we will now not need to buy.
Yes.
I obviously can't tell you which trees they are, but we will save 150,000 trees a year that will not need to go to the production of virgin paper by the virtue of our use of recycled paper. And I think this will have a multiplier effect because, as I said, I believe that since DOD is such a large purchaser of paper, the fact that DOD begins to buy recycled paper, then we'll be able to influence other entities to buy recycled paper as well, particularly as the price of it drops below virgin paper.
Do you really think that the pulp paper companies in this country are going to conserve these trees rather than harvest them?
Oh, I think this, combined with efforts towards sustainable management of forests, obviously this not alone, but if you're talking about how we manage our forests so that they can be sustainable, there are a number of other efforts in place, all of which are important to sustainable use of forests. Yes?
You know, every desk, every office that you walk into in this building, pretty much all over DOD, has got those little boxes, recycled, no yellow paper. You know, is that figured into the cost savings on this? I mean, we recycle. I imagine we get paid for it, right? DOD gets paid for that paper.
Yes,
that
we
figured
recycle.
Into this, too? Into the whole way that you've...
Now, these figures are based just on the fact that we will be purchasing recycled rather than virgin paper.
But we already
recycle. You know, all those boxes you see around the Pentagon, which I've worked very hard in the last few years to make sure are at sufficient intervals in the Pentagon so that people can use them. We did a little, Secretary Perry a few years ago did a little recycling ceremony to promote recycling among the DOD workforce. We have recycling programs at every military base, and it is very successful.
But no idea how much we're saving or getting out of that. How much does a box of paper cost when you figure that in is what I'm looking for.
That's a good question.
We can get you some of those figures. We'll get you some of those figures on the facts of the DOD, overall DOD recycling program.
Okay. Thank you very much. I want to let everybody know that in 7 minutes, we will have Chapter 3 of this afternoon's events, and Ken Bacon will be here to cover any other subjects you may care to discuss.
Good afternoon. Just want to start with a brief comment about the military child care program. As you know, earlier today, the President highlighted the quality of military child care and asked the military to work with civilian organizations to help them improve the quality of child care around the country. And we will work with HHS in order to do that. And this is being handled by Carolyn Beecraft, who's the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Personnel, working under Ed Dorn. There are, of course, very good military child care facilities in the area, and I'd just like to highlight four of them for you if you want to go out and pursue this issue. I'll give you one from each service. The Army has one at Fort Meade, the Air Force at Andrews, the Navy at Anacostia Naval Station, and the Marine Corps at Quantico. Those are all nearby, and we can get you contacts and numbers for those if you're interested in pursuing this. With that, I'll take your questions on child care or anything else.
Charlie. Isn't there a child care facility here at the Pentagon?
There is one at the Pentagon, yes. And you're certainly, we can certainly arrange for you to go to that child care facility as well if you want to review that. Yes.
I have the Secretary's and the Pentagon's reaction to the DoD approval today of the law requiring continued lease of private property in Japan to the U.S. military for basing.
We are pleased by that approval. As you know, when the Secretary was in Japan, he met with Prime Minister Hashimoto, and he emerged from that meeting with confidence that this would be approved by the Prime Minister's party, and it was. We believe that the continued presence of U.S. troops in the Asia-Pacific and in Japan and in Okinawa is important, and this will allow our troops to continue defending the Asia-Pacific area. Yes, Ivan.
Ken, would you give us the latest you have on the missing A-10? One of the news organizations is reporting as of a couple hours ago that the Air Force is scaling back the search and just turning it over to the Civil Air Patrol, and that the three-star general has been recalled to Tucson.
Well, he is going back to Davis-Monthan, but he will be replaced by another general who will continue with the search. There's no diminution of our concern and of our efforts to get to the bottom of this. General Campbell also said that we had been able to detect what he called an infrared event at the time when the plane may have been lost, and we will investigate that further. The problem is that the location where that occurred is in a very high avalanche area, and apparently the location is under some 18 feet of snow, and it's not an area that can be explored at this time. So we have to wait for either avalanche crews to go up there and shake loose the snow to reduce the threat, or for some melting to take place.
One follow-up on that. Is the building, the Air Force, the Secretary, whomever, satisfied now that the plane, in fact, did crash into the mountains in that general area around Vail or Aspen?
I think we just have to wait for the search to continue and come to a conclusion before we speculate. There's been a lot of speculation about what happened. Frankly, I'd rather wait for the results. Speculation won't help find the answer at this stage. Only searching will help find that answer. Yes.
Any other subject? Mr. Bacon, a DOD official yesterday delivered a background speech on the Greek-Turkish differences here in Washington. According to Athens News Agency, the same official news agency of the Greek government, your official stated that a package has been formulated for the solution over the Aegean issues in Cyprus by DOD, White House, and the State Department, which has been already coordinated by your ambassadors in Athens, Ankara, and Nicosia, somewhere in Europe 2 weeks ago, and the most important, that this package is in the hands of President Clinton to be announced as a U.S. initiative. Since the Greek spokesman today, Mr. Repas, are EPAS has denied the existence of such a package. Could you please confirm the context of the speech by your official?
I believe that the official who was talking on background yesterday said that our ambassadors to Athens, Ankara, and Cyprus had met recently to discuss the situation there. I don't believe he said that that there was a new package that had been presented to President Clinton. We continue to work very hard for a peaceful resolution of this dispute. You know our position as well as anybody. It's been explained to you many times by Mr. Burns and others. And we do believe that there should be a peaceful and durable solution to the Cyprus problem. We're working towards that now. I think it would be we've been working towards it for a long while, and we'll continue to work towards it.
Do you know where in Europe they met the three ambassadors since it was mentioned by your official? Do you know where?
Where they met?
Yes.
I don't. I think they met in Zurich. Yes, they met with a Department of State official who'd been traveling in the area, Kerry Kavanaugh, and at the end of his trip, he met with the three ambassadors in Zurich, and our embassies continue to work towards a solution of this.
Mr. Baker, could you please clarify if the whole speech, as it was delivered yesterday, including the question-answer period, reflects DOD policy vis-à-vis to the Aegean issues in Cyprus, or that's his personal opinion?
He was a DOD official talking about our policies.
And the last question on the issue, it was reported that the controversial special advisor to the Greek Prime Minister, Christos Rozakis, R-O-Z-A-K-S, most recently was here for more than 30 days. I would like to know if he met with the DOD officials, too, during his stay here in Washington.
I don't know the answer to that. We'll try to find out.
Thank you.
Yes, Bill.
Yes, thanks, Ken. Nice to see you. Ken, can the DOD confirm a test about 2 weeks ago by the Iranians of a medium range ballistic missile with an unconventional capability in warhead, that is. This was reported by the Israeli Defense Minister earlier this week. Have you any knowledge of that?
I do not, and I cannot confirm it.
And then I would ask, there's in Jane's today, there's a report of the Iranians publicly proclaiming they are going to drop all of their missiles. All their missile programs, their purchase from the Koreans or the Chinese, because they're afraid that if they don't, they want to drop the pretext of a preemptive strike by the Israelis of their nuclear facilities. Do you think this is smoke, or do you have any comment?
There is no need for the Iranians to build up their forces in the Gulf, and it certainly would be prudent for them to make a commitment to peace rather than to war, make a commitment to disarmament rather than to armament. The Iranian economy is facing difficulties now, and they could well use money to promote their economic growth and stability rather than an arms race in the Gulf. I cannot comment on that particular report. That sounds to me as if it's a question the Iranians should answer, because they can best describe their own weapons purchase programs.
Well, I was just asking if you thought it was credible what they were saying about avoiding attack by the Israelis by scrapping their missiles.
I think that the Iranians are best able to comment on the credibility of their own weapons purchase programs.
Ken, is there any indication that Iran is attempting to buy anti-aircraft missiles or handheld missiles from Russia, and have we had any discussions with Russia about that?
Well, this was addressed at great length by Mike McCurry at the White House yesterday. I don't have much to add to that. We have discussed, as Mike McCurry said, with the Russians over several years our concern about a buildup by the Iranian military with Russian help. We believe that the area will be more stable if arms sales are held to a minimum to Iran. And we also have told the Russians that we believe that arming Iran could ultimately be a threat to all countries in the area. So we have made our position very clear to the Russians. It is brought up almost every time President Clinton meets with President Yeltsin, and it's brought up in at other levels as well. Yes, Suzanne.
On the QDR, people said that once the secretary had his Asia trip behind him, he'd be getting deep into that. Can you give us a sense of what kind of meetings he's attending or how many hours a day he's spending on this issue, what his plans are before the run-up to the QDR?
Well, as you know, he went to Florida on Tuesday and Wednesday and just returned from Florida. And then as soon as he got back, he went to the Blair House meeting with congressional leaders on foreign policy last night for the foreign policy retreat with the president. He has 34 hours planned for making decisions on the QDR issues between now and the middle of May. It will be one of his primary preoccupations. He's going to be—he's set up a series of Saturday meetings to go over QDR issues in depth, and that's what he will be spending a large block of his time on over the next month. He also, of course, has to run the department and do all the other things that the Secretary of Defense does. One of the things he'll be working on certainly is winning Senate approval, ratification of the Chemical Weapons Convention. And you got earlier today the statement from three former Secretaries of Defense in support of that, and also General Shalikashvili's remarks. Yes.
Ken, could you give us a couple of examples of the sorts of things that the Pentagon is doing with child care and child development that caught the White House's attention?
Yeah, I'd be glad to do that. They're basically the president focused on a number of ways in which the military child care is exemplary. The first was a much higher percentage of military child care programs have been certified by the National Association for the Education of Young Children than throughout the country as a whole. About more than 70% of the military child care programs have been so certified versus 5% nationally. So he focused basically on that as a model and asked us to help work with other child care programs, state, local, private child care programs, to help them through the certification process and to teach them what needs to be done to win certification. But he focused also on a number of other things that the Pentagon has done. One is provide adequate financial support for its programs. Two, strict oversight of the programs, including unannounced inspections. Three, providing attractive wage and benefit programs for workers in the child care program so we get high-quality workers providing high-quality care to the children of men and women in the military. And four, mandatory training for child care providers. We recruit good people, we pay them well, and we train them. And the other I've already mentioned, which is meeting the national accreditation standards at a much higher level than nationally.
One final one on the A-10, if I could. You were asked if they're going to cut back the search, and you said there's no diminution of our concern on our efforts to get to the bottom of this. I assume you meant by that you're not going to cut back. The search is not being cut back.
Well, the tempo of the search may change from day to day, depending on weather conditions, depending on the number of sites left to search, our access to the sites. We are not going to diminish in any way our effort to find out what happened to that A-10.
Another A-10 question.
Yes.
This week, as you know, is the anniversary of the attack or the raid on the Branch Davidian compound and the bombing in Oklahoma City. with the proximity of the search to Denver, where the trial is going on of Mr. McVeigh, is there any plan by DOD or any effort underway to make sure that air defenses in that area are secure in light of the fact that this airplane is unaccounted for?
We always try to make sure that our air defenses are secure.
Extra effort.
And I think that it is, we are, I think I haven't thought about that proposal, about that speculation, and everybody seems to believe that the crash is the most likely outcome of what happened to this plane.
Thank you.
Hey, yeah, Charlie, you can leave if you want. Yeah.
Quick question. In the coming weeks, there's a couple senior leaders in DOD who are leaving, Dr. Kaminsky, Secretary Page. Can you just give us an idea of where the process is in finding replacements for them? I know Dr. Kaminsky, for example, said May 9th would be his official last day. He may come back, I guess, for a couple days afterward, but.
Well, I can describe the process in a word, active. I believe that we will be able to announce a successor to Secretary Dorn, Undersecretary Dorn, relatively soon. There is an active search underway for somebody to replace Undersecretary Kaminsky, but that has not produced a firm candidate yet. We hope that in the next couple of weeks it will. I don't know where the search to replace General Page stands, but that is ongoing as well.
Has the White House put any limits on the number of Republicans that can fill those positions?
No, the White House has not limited the appointments by Secretary Cohen in any way.
Go ahead.
Yes, Bill.
In that line, has the Secretary made any recommendations in terms of filling the number two slot at the CIA with a military individual?
I don't know the answer to that question. Clearly, a return to the past practice of having a senior military official operate as the deputy at the CIA is under consideration. It's something that's always been an option, and it's under consideration today. The Pentagon, the Department of Defense, would clearly be in favor of such an arrangement. About 80% of the intelligence budget is consumed by military programs, and we have a very strong interest in the overall management of these programs by the DCI. We have had very smooth relationships with, obviously, with Director Deutsch when he was at the CIA, and I anticipate that we'll have very smooth relationships with Director Tenet, should he be confirmed by the Senate, as I expect. Whether or not there's a senior military officer there, but clearly a senior military officer would bring a type of expertise that would be helpful.
Ken, have you any reaction to a claim by Iranian dissidents that their sources inside the Iranian government have conclusive evidence that the Iranian government gave the orders, and not only they prepared for, but executed the orders of on the bombing of Khobar, the Khobar Towers. And this is, by the way, in line with the German judge's proclamation that the Supreme Security Council of Iran is giving the orders for these kinds of terrorist attacks. Have you any reaction to that, sir?
The Justice Department is handling this investigation, and I think all questions on where that stands and what we think happened should be left to the Justice Department at this stage. Yes.
Follow-up on Khobar Towers. Has Secretary Cohen begun to look at the latest Air Force review?
He has not. Mr. Lambrose.
Yes. According to documents, secret Greek-Turkish negotiations are taking place now in Brussels over confidence measures in the Aegean Sea with NATO and U.S. involvement. The Turkish side stated that so far there are no maritime borders in the Aegean, considering the entire area totally open all the way through 6 miles off the coast of the mainland of Greece. And also the Turkish side stated that does not recognize the limits of the Athens FIR, demanding all the Greek planes to report direct to the Turkish aviation authorities. My question to you, since you are involved in those discussions, how do you define the area of the Greek-Turkish borders and the Athens FIR during your military presence the last years up to the present?
Mr. Lambros, did you say those were secret negotiations taking place in Brussels?
That's correct.
I'd be the last person to comment on secret negotiations taking place in Brussels.
I don't want to comment on the content of the negotiation. I would like just my question to you is, how do you define the Greek-Turkish borders and the Athens FIR during your military presence in the area?
I don't want to get into that right now. I can't define it. I don't know the definition. We'll get you our definition if we can.
Thank you. Well, maybe Charlie. One wind-up. When Mike's birthday was today, we'd all like to know how old he is.
I think that that's a question you should address to Mike, but I can tell you he's as old as I am.
How old is that?
Greetings. Welcome to our briefing. First, I'd like to welcome a couple of people here. Mr. James Buchanan, who's president of the Buchanan Company in Southfield, Michigan, and is president of the Defense Orientation Conference Association. This is a group of, it's sort of like the postgraduate course of the Joint Civilian Orientation Conference, which is a group of civilians who come together every year, different group every year, and they travel around the country visiting military bases for a week as a way to learn more about how the military operates and what its capabilities and values are. So we welcome Mr. Buchanan here. I'd also like to welcome Mr. Sakane of Japan. He's the international affairs correspondent of NHK Nagoya, which is a Japanese public broadcasting station, and he's here as one of the USIA's endless string of visitors, and we welcome him as well. Let me start with a couple of remarks about the support we're providing to the flood victims in North Dakota. We have, among other things, provided through the Army Corps of Engineers about 5.5 million sandbags and 220 pumps. We've also, the Corps of Engineers have installed 50 generators provided by FEMA, which of course is the lead agency in helping the people of North Dakota deal with the floods. And we currently have 560 engineers or members of the Corps of Engineers out there working on dikes, levees, and other activities to prevent the floodwaters from attacking new targets such as hospitals. In addition, we have through the engineers worked on 33 separate locations to try to hold back the floodwaters. The Air Force is providing now housing for approximately 3,000 evacuees, and they're prepared to help many more should that number rise. There are approximately 850 airmen working on flood control, damage limitation efforts going on out there today, and another 60 personnel from air bases outside of North Dakota have been sent in to the Grand Forks Air Force Base Hospital to assist in the provision of care to civilian evacuees. Finally, TRANSCOM has brought in a wide range of supplies, the 50 generators I mentioned earlier, 4,000 blankets, 900 sleeping bags, and 90 pallets of Red Cross supplies. And they've brought in a number of medical personnel as well, teams both from FEMA and from the Public Health Service. So that's an overview of the support the Defense Department is providing out there. Army Secretary Togo West is out there today with President Clinton assessing the damage and what we can do to help limit it. There are also, finally, I should mention, 2,181 members of the National Guard who have been called on active duty to help provide support for the flood operations. With that, I'll take your questions. Suzanne.
On the flood, do you have any idea how many flights TRANSCOM's made?
I'm afraid I don't, but we can try to find out.
And on the 3,000 evacuees, are they primarily at the air base?
Yes, that's where they are.
Or are there other sites?
No, they're at the air base, I believe.
Elizabeth Dole is scheduled to meet with Secretary Cohen, I think, today or tomorrow. Is it about the flooding?
No, she met with him yesterday, and the primary topic of discussion was anti-personnel landmines. Charlie?
On the situation in Iraq, the President and the State Department have made it pretty clear the United States doesn't intend to shoot down what they call civilian helicopters that Iraq might use to transport civilians across the no fly zone from the Hajj. Number one, has Iraq says it's going to, has it started to move these helicopters yet? And could you clarify the position? What if there are military helicopters used to transport these people?
Well, what the President said was that we were not going to interfere with the exercise of religious rights, privileges, and faith. And we are not going to do that. We've made it extremely clear, both in words and in deeds over the years, that we are prepared to enforce the no-fly, no-drive zone, which was set up to prevent Iraq from increasing its military power south of the 32nd parallel. In other words, increasing its military power in a way that could threaten Kuwait or Saudi Arabia. And that remains our goal, and we will enforce both the no-fly and the no-drive zone in order to do that.
How do you know if Iraq uses military helicopters that it's not doing that? Are they communicating with you? And have they started to move these people?
I think that we have ways of telling whether they're mobilizing forces. In this case, they are not mobilizing forces. I think it's heartening that Saddam Hussein, who has shown relatively little interest in the welfare of his people over the last 6 or 7 years, spent vast amounts of resources rebuilding his palaces and attempting to rebuild his military while his people have starved and gone without medicine. I think it's encouraging that he is acting to help tired and ill pilgrims, as he said. And we don't intend to interfere with his ability to provide humanitarian aid to pilgrims. But I think we can discriminate between relatively limited humanitarian missions on the one hand and military mobilizations or movements on the other hand.
Have you started to move these people yet, and how are they communicating with you regarding the movements?
They don't typically communicate with us, and I'm sure they have. I don't believe they've communicated with us in this case.
And have they started moving again?
We believe that they have moved helicopters down to just north of the border with Saudi Arabia. It will. There are 104 pilgrims who have been moved up to that area, and that will require probably 3 or 4 utility helicopters to move those pilgrims out.
So, is it only going to be for religious observances, or can a helicopter that maybe wants to deliver some rice to a village can then be another exception? And so on and so forth.
Well, the Hajj only happens once a year, so I wouldn't anticipate that this would be an everyday event. We are not planning to make widespread exceptions for helicopter traffic in the area, but our main goal remains unchanged, and that is to prevent military buildups in the southern part of Iraq, and I think we're fully capable of doing that. And as I said, I think we can discriminate between relatively small-scale humanitarian operations on the one hand and military movements on the other.
So you're saying small-scale humanitarian flights into the no-fly zone are okay?
Our preference is that there be no flights in the no-fly zone, but we're not prepared to stop what seem to be small-scale and reasonable humanitarian actions. But there's a big difference between that and any type of military mobilization.
Understand.
Military helicopters?
Yes, I believe they're Russian military. They're the same types of helicopters are used by the Russian military, yeah. I think they're MI-8s and 17s, I believe, is what they are.
And they came south to the to at least close to the border with Saudi Arabia?
They did not cross the border. My understanding is they have not crossed the border. They've come close to the border, and then the pilgrims will be taken across the border.
Did they come that far south without any warning?
Well, they came that far south. I mean, we basically announced yesterday that we weren't going to shoot down these helicopters transporting pilgrims. Dana.
Until after we announced that.
Pardon?
They didn't come south until after we made that clear.
They did not.
How many helicopters are there, sir?
As I said, it would take about 3 or 4 helicopters to transport that many pilgrims. I also understand there's a helicopter of press people as well.
Shot that down? No.
Are you asking if we shot it down or if they did?
Fill in a couple more of the real basic questions.
Just for the record, no helicopters have been shot down. I want to make sure the transcript reflects that.
So have 3 or 4 helicopters already flown into the no-fly zone? Can you tell us what time that happened?
No, I can't, and I actually can't tell you the numbers right now. I'm just telling you that it would take 3 or 4 helicopters to transport that number of pilgrims.
Have been a number of helicopters that have flown into the no-fly zone as we speak already.
Well, I have not seen them, but I have read reports that the helicopters have gone there.
Well, so as not to rely on Saddam Hussein's reporting, do you have information from the task force enforcing the no-fly zone that indeed a number of helicopters did fly into it?
We have information that several helicopters have gone into the area, yes.
Can you tell us what time that was?
No, I can't. I'm afraid I just don't know.
Can you say whether there was an effort to communicate on the part of Iraq, or was there any communication on the part of Iraq with the task force pilots or what have you to let them know they were coming?
No, not that I'm aware of.
Were any warnings given by the task force that they weren't to come, that they were to turn around?
No, not that I'm aware of. As I said, we made a public statement yesterday about our response to this. Yes.
Did Saudi Arabia not give them permission to enter Saudi territory? Is that why they've stopped on that side of the border?
Well, you'll have to ask the Saudis about that, but it was perfectly easy for them to stay within Iraqi territory and have the pilgrims, even though they are sick and exhausted, apparently walk the short distance to the helicopters.
The Saudis had an AWACS aircraft of their own up and a couple of helicopters to try to determine how many choppers the Iraqis were bringing down. Is that how we got our information about how many choppers or the choppers of the Iraqis were flown?
I'm not aware of what the Saudi force dispositions were in the area.
So you can't confirm whether there was a Saudi AWACS aircraft?
No. I mean, they can confirm that, I assume, but I'm not speaking for their forces. Jim.
Ken, is there a concern that this is going to be followed up with more challenges to the no-fly zone? Since in fact they defy the no-fly zone and nothing, there's been no response at all from the United States.
Well, so I said earlier, we believe we can adequately discriminate between small-scale humanitarian operations on the one hand and military mobilizations on the other. Our goal of enforcing the no-fly, no-drive zone is to prevent them from mobilizing their forces in the south, and I believe we can do that. We've also shown that we're willing to enforce that, and I don't think there should be any doubt in Saddam Hussein's part that we are willing to enforce the no-fly, no-drive zone.
Thank you.
Does this constitute a change in United States policy with regard to enforcing the no-fly zone?
I don't believe it does, no.
Because?
Because it isn't.
Well, they're flying in the no-fly zone,
which they've never done before.
It is not a change in our policy.
Well, it's a question on that. I had always understood since the end of the war that the rule was no armed helicopter flights, and now you're defining it, as I understand what you just said, about discriminating on the basis of the mission as opposed to armed or unarmed. So, by definition, if you're discriminating now on the basis of the mission and the intent of the mission, does humanitarian mission, by U.S. definition, mean absolutely unarmed? Assured that these helicopters are not armed, and by definition, future humanitarian flights must be unarmed?
I'm not prepared to make a sweeping statement about that because I cannot describe for you the helicopters that they sent down there.
Do you know whether they have any arms, or they have any arms?
I do not know.
We don't know. So how do we know that they're humanitarian?
Know that they went down to pick up 104 pilgrims and that they sent a small number of helicopters to do that. And as the President said, we're not going to interfere with the exercise of religious liberties.
So I'm sorry to press it just one more time, but you can't say whether this definition of a humanitarian flight means armed or unarmed.
Well, there are ways for the Iraqis to seek permission from the UN Security Council for various types of activities in the no-fly zone. In this case, they did not seek permission to do that. We wish they had, but they did not. But our decision was not to interfere with this humanitarian mission. And I go back to the point that I think it's we're perfectly able to tell the difference between a small-scale humanitarian mission on the one hand and military operations on the other.
But you don't regard this as Saddam Hussein finding a little chink in your armor, a way to tweak the nose of the great Satan by taking a couple of helicopters down there and...
I regard this as Saddam Hussein showing that he's a good Muslim and supporting other good Muslims who have made their pilgrimage to Mecca. Yes?
I have a question. After the Black Hawk shoot down in 95, why are you guys so certain you'll be able to distinguish between a military operation and a humanitarian operation?
What I said was that we would be able to distinguish between small-scale humanitarian operations and military mobilizations. And I believe that's the case. Dana.
Can I go back to the question of whether or not this is a change in policy? The rhetoric of the policy, at least I believe, has been fairly consistent that you wouldn't tolerate any flights in the no-fly zone without having sought permission from the U.S. or from the U.N. So is this the first time that Iraq has carried out a small-scale humanitarian mission without having asked permission from the UN? What I'm getting at is...
Yeah, I can't answer that question. I just don't know the history to be able to say whether it's the first time they've carried out a humanitarian operation. They have flown helicopters in the no-fly zone before. I know that, but I can't describe them. I don't know whether they were humanitarian operations or not.
But they were always at risk when they were flying before, weren't they?
Well, yeah. I'm not saying that future helicopter flights won't be at risk. In this particular case, because it was clearly a religious or a humanitarian operation to bring back religious pilgrims, we took the stance that we did.
Well, my question is that it tries to get at the fact perhaps there is a de facto policy in effect that we don't know about, and this is the first time we've found out that there's a helicopter mission that's you know, that you're permitting that falls outside of what seemed to be what you would permit before. So? Well, so either there have been missions like this before, and you say you don't, you can't answer that question?
I'm saying I'm not aware of earlier humanitarian missions. There may well have been, but I'm not personally aware of them.
So why, again, why doesn't this amount to a change in policy?
It has not been our policy to interfere with small-scale humanitarian operations. That's not our policy. Yes?
What are currently, then, the rules of engagement for U.S. pilots or Allied pilots patrolling the no-fly zone when they encounter a helicopter?
We don't discuss rules of engagement in any specificity, but what we've shown in the past is that we will take appropriate actions, one, to protect our forces, and two, to prevent Iraq from assembling military power in the south of its country. And that's the point of the no-fly, no-drive zone.
Has there been an increase?
And that remains unchanged.
Has there been an increased number of sorties in which the U.S. can monitor this?
No, but there are a large number of sorties on an average day, frequently over 100 sorties in an average day. So we have fairly complete coverage of the no-fly zone. We don't cover all of the no-fly zone every day, but we cover, we fly enough to cover vast parts of the no-fly zone.
Has Iraq increased its level of air defense integration or preparedness during this time frame?
Well, Iraq clearly has been watching our response, I think it's fair to say. Bill?
Another topic?
No, just one more thing. Does the Saudi government specifically ask the United States not to interfere with these humanitarian flights from Hajj?
I'm not aware that they have, but we are, as the President made very clear, not only aware of, but supportive of the exercise of religious liberties and of faith. And we made a decision to allow this.
How are the pilgrims getting from, presumably they're in Mecca or Medina, how are they getting from the holy mosques to the helicopter pickup point?
I don't know how they got there. That's something you should ask the Saudis, because that... As I said, I can't answer your question. The Saudis will have to answer that question. It happened in their territory.
Presumably the Saudis are cooperating with the transport of the pilgrims.
Well, the pilgrims got there, as I understand it. So, yes, presumably they allowed them to get there.
And to get back to across the border to where the helicopters are.
Well, as I said, those are questions you should ask the Saudi press operation in Washington.
Sorties, has there been any change in security posture?
I did not say we'd increase sorties.
I'm sorry, other than that question, you're right, you didn't say that. But has there been any change in U.S. security posture?
Not that I'm aware of, no. Charlie?
Changes.
Bill was going to change over there.
Thank you. Yes, Ken, regarding the defector Wang Jiang Yap, it was reported yesterday that he had spoken about plans by the North Korean military to attack, to burn the countryside of South Korea. And there was some mention of a possible nuclear component to this attack. So I would ask, while the South Koreans are interviewing him, debriefing him, does the United States have an interest, immediate interest, to ask the South Koreans or jointly interview this this gentleman, Mr. Wang, about the North Korean nuclear capability and whatever plans they might have to use such a capability? Is that not urgent?
It is certainly of great interest to us. The South Koreans have promised to share their information with us, and also they have made it very clear that we will have our own access, independent access, to defector Wang.
But would we be willing to wait until we had independent access, or would we be asking the South Koreans for whatever they... Certainly the burning question is nuclear, right?
Well, it is one of several questions we have, yes.
And we would want to know whatever they find out immediately.
Well, to the extent that it's been reported in the press, we have one version of what he said already. As I said, we work very closely with the South Koreans. We're allies on the peninsula, and we will also have a chance to talk with them independently.
Understood. Thank you.
Well, I think we'll probably let the South Koreans talk with them for a while. I would guess it'd be several weeks. But in the meantime, we'll be sharing information with the, or they'll be sharing information with us.
Have they not been talking to them over the course of the last month and a half?
They have not really started systematic discussions with him prior to his arrival in South Korea, as I understand it. Remember, he was in Beijing for a while. And it's my understanding that there wasn't much communication with him then. Then he moved to the Philippines. Now he's in the Republic of Korea. I think there'll be ample time for both the South Koreans and for us to talk with Mr. Wong. Charlie.
Situations
I have a follow-up question?
Yeah, Jim.
While he was in the Philippines, did the U.S. have a chance to talk to the North Korean defector?
No. We were waiting.
Haven't spoken to him at all up to this point?
I believe that's the case, yes. Charlie.
More North Korea.
Yeah. Did the U.S. have independent verification of what we've read today, that indeed the North Koreans have a nuclear capability?
Our intelligence community obviously has looked very closely at that. At around the time of the framework agreement, which was designed to shut down their nuclear program, we believe that they had generated enough plutonium to make at least one nuclear weapon. I checked before coming in here with in the military balance put out by the International Institute for Strategic Studies, and they phrased it this way, referring to the framework agreement. It is generally believed that the North Korean nuclear program is frozen, although there can be no absolute assurance that it does not already possess a small number of nuclear weapons. As I said, our intelligence people who have assessed this believe that they probably, that they could have generated enough plutonium to make at least one nuclear weapon.
Could have, but did they?
I think I'll stick with what I said. It was pretty clear.
I guess, what are we to make of what appears to be a fairly startling piece of information?
We've been talking about the, we clearly regarded the North Korean nuclear program as a threat. In 1994, we were preparing a major surge of our forces over the question of whether the North Koreans would, to compel them to stop what we believed was work on a nuclear program. We succeeded in forcing them to stop through negotiations. That led to the agreed framework agreement. And we believe that they have frozen their nuclear program since 1994 and that that program remains frozen. There are inspectors who have been in and out of North Korea looking at their reactors. And as you know, as part of the agreed framework program, there's a number of events that have to take place in terms of supplying fuel oil and in terms of building less threatening nuclear reactors to generate power. And that process is ongoing now. But I can't move the ball beyond what we said back in 94 and have said since and what I said today.
Well, do you consider this report fairly troubling then? You're not disputing
it. I consider the North Koreans' military capability troubling. The United States does. We have 37,000 troops in South Korea. They have the world's fourth largest military, fourth largest army. 50% of it is arrayed along the demilitarized zone. They have extensive artillery trained on South Korea. They have missiles, we know, and they have worked very hard to build dangerous and threatening weapons. That's one of the reasons we're trying to engage them in four-party talks to lead to a peace agreement on the Korean Peninsula.
Mr. Wong's assessment that, or his belief that North Korea is preparing for war and intends to go to war, if I read the statement that is credited to him correctly, is that an intent which surprises, worries? How is that statement? Well,
first of all, we have in connection with the Republic of Korea, very strong defenses and very robust military forces in Korea today. Those forces since 1994 have been improved in several very specific and meaningful ways. We've improved dramatically our counter-battery radar, for instance, our ability to locate artillery shooting at us and to fire back at it very, very quickly. We've improved our helicopters. We do not see today, nor have we seen recently, any signs of increased military preparedness on the part of North Korea. Indeed, one of the, although this is a very powerful and threatening and certainly serious military force arrayed against the Republic of Korea and against our own forces, the general level of exercise and training has fallen off somewhat in the last several years from what it had been in the past. And we attribute this in part to the impact of their economic problems. But I want to make two points. One, it is a very significant military force. It is now, and it has been in the past, and we believe it will be in the future. And two, we do not see signs of increased preparedness today.
It seemed to me that his statement was more directed rather than at a systematic, logical escalation on the part of North Korea, but more a level of mental intent on the part of the leadership, whereby whether they were ready or not, whether they had made mass preparations or not, it still might be a more live possibility than many of us who have been watching this for a long time might have thought. That's what I'm trying to get at.
I think that I can't psychoanalyze Defector Wong, and I certainly can't psychoanalyze the state of mind of the North Koreans. Suffice it to say, they have a significant military force. It's a force we take very seriously, and it's a force we have worked very hard to counter. We believe we have a very powerful defensive force that could respond extremely quickly with devastating power to any attack they made against us or the Republic of Korea. We have, in the last 3 or 4 years, taken a number of actions to improve the ability of our forces there. Secretary Cohen was recently in Korea. Some of you traveled with him. And he had a chance to assess firsthand in his meetings with General Tulele, his visit to Osan, his visit to the 2nd Infantry Division at Camp Casey. He had a chance to assess with his own eyes and ears the readiness of these forces. They're extremely ready. They're well prepared. But as I say, our goal now and in the past and in the future will be to convince North Korea that it is futile for them to think of military solutions to the problems on the peninsula. Instead, they should agree to sit down and negotiate with the four parties, the other three parties, toward a peace agreement on the Korean Peninsula. Yes, Suzanne.
Change the subject?
No. Japanese reported to be interested in having an interview with Mr. Han also and to participate in the interview. Did they ask U.S. to join the interview?
I'm not aware that they asked us if they could join with us. I've read the same report you've read, and I would just refer you to the Japanese government on that. I can't speak for the Japanese government on what their plans are.
This August report that he wrote is detailed enough to allow the U.S. to verify whether or not they do have nuclear weapons? Has he named a site? Has he named any specifics that would allow you to then try to figure figure out whether it was...
I do not know that. No, I can't answer that question.
And I have a question parallels the last. Secretary Cohen said, quote, the United States will have access to this defector to find out what's in the hearts and minds of the Korean leadership. I take it that the U.S. government regards Wang as very credible. Is that correct?
He has been the leading ideologue of North Korea, which is a state that seems to live more in ideology than food. So he's been a very important person. And I think we take the information we can get from any defector seriously. He is a very high-level defector, so we will obviously listen with great interest to what he says.
Do we believe he's telling us the truth?
Well, that's one of the things we'll have to find out. But that's one of the reasons we want to talk to him ourselves.
Just to make sure I understand something way back to the beginning, you believe there's a possibility that North Korea holds weapons-grade plutonium outside of the agreed IAEA program that was supposed to freeze their capacity and their nuclear infrastructure. You believe did I understand you right? Believe there's a possibility they hold weapons-grade plutonium outside of that regime?
Let me repeat what I said earlier, because I want it to be exactly what I said before. Our intelligence community believes that they may have acquired enough plutonium to make at least one weapon. I don't think I want to go beyond that. That's been our stance for several years, and it remains our stance. And in addition, I read to you a public statement that anybody can read from the military balance.
Would that not be a violation of the IAEA agreement, however?
We are talking about what happened before the agreed framework agreement. We believe that their nuclear program has been frozen as of the time that agreement was signed, which I believe was in October of 1994. We believe that they have honored that agreement since October of 1994. That agreement, the framework agreement, was a huge diplomatic achievement because it shut down what we worried was a nuclear program. But the agreement only took effect in October of 1994, and their program predated that agreement.
But you believe the plutonium is frozen somehow within the confines of the monitoring capability that was set up by that agreement?
That's not what I said. I said we believe that they may have generated enough plutonium to build at least one nuclear weapon.
But did you know that before the October 94 agreement was signed? And was that grandfathered in somehow?
There was no grandfathering in to allow them to continue a nuclear weapons program. The entire point of the framework agreement was to shut down a program that we believed was designed to allow them to produce a nuclear arsenal. And we succeeded in shutting down that program.
But the agreement does not prohibit them from maintaining, from holding the plutonium that they may have already had.
I'd have to go back and look at the agreement, but our assessment of their program is exactly what I told you.
Was that assessment made before October 94?